I've got to go get a robe on, and I don't know where my minion is.
Thank you.
Today, right? Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Wow. That's great. It is so good to be with you all this morning. And I have a couple things that I am particularly joyful about as we come to this time of Advent. Usually when Advent comes rolling in, that means the Alberts are back with us. And we're so grateful to see them back from Arizona, huh? Y'all can surely do this. Surely you can do this. And the other thing is, I want to give a shout out to one of our people who view us on Facebook every week. Her name is Cheryl. I'm not going to give her last name because it's Facebook. But she was going to come with her mother today to be with us and had some medical things that happened. And I just want her to know, if she's watching, that we love her and that we're praying for her. Amen?
Amen?
So you guys do this for me. Turn around and like wave at the Facebook camera. So if Cheryl and Gene are watching, they know that she and Gene are in your hearts this morning. All right, it's time for our Advent candle lighting. Today we light the candle of anticipation. And so as we wait, we wait in anticipation with patience.
God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourself with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Patience.
Amen. 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 This has been a morning for patience. And so let's ask God to be with us this morning, all right? Our Father in heaven, you are nearer than our breath. We thank you for these days of Advent, and we thank you for this new year in Christ Jesus. We confess that the thought of your second coming gives us some comfort and some joy to think about what might be there. But sometimes we're frightened. And so we ask today that you come in mightiness and power and root out that fear from our lives,
that your energy and that your peace rule our hearts. We ask you today to wrap us up in the armor of light. Come, Holy Spirit, and wrap us in the arms of the life and the love of Jesus. In his most precious name, he is the one who has come, the one who is here with us, and the one who is coming again for his glory and our good. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Good morning, Chapel Hill. My name is Kara Coffey. I'm a service worship leader, and I thank you so much for joining us, whether in person or online today. With me, I'm blessed to have Carrie Turner and Tracy Simon with the band, and then we have praise singers with us this morning as well, James Anthony and then Rick and Francie Wilkins. If you are interested, oh yes, excellent.
Chaplain Posey, don't you think that Charles Wesley is smiling in heaven hearing his song be played like that?
Amen.
Chaplain Posey is here, y'all, this morning with us. So grateful. So grateful to have him here. I guess the best thing that we get to do is to ask God to be with us, right? to pray and to lift all those people up who need our prayers, who need God to come into their life. On this second Sunday of Advent, we remember that there's another life that's coming, and that's what we'll be talking about today. But right now, here we are. Here we are in a world that God is holding together with us, that our faith has to be strong, right? And so let's place these people in our hearts, all of the people in our hearts, all of the places in our hearts that need God's help as we go to this God of ours in prayer. Will you bow with me, please? Our Father in heaven, you are nearer than my breath. We thank you for these days of Advent. We thank you for this new year. As we remember that you are the Alpha and that you are the Omega, that you are the beginning and that you are the end. And we ask you today to awaken us afresh. Forgive us, Lord. Forgive us when we cause others to feel unsafe. Forgive us when people don't trust us. Forgive us, Lord, for insisting on our own way. Forgive us when we don't tell the whole truth. Forgive us when somewhere deep in our hearts we just discount those things that are legitimate needs for others. And remind us today, God, that on the inside we're the same. We ask you, God, to hear people as we live them silently. Precious God, we ask you today to make us good stewards of this earth, of our water and our air. May we be humble, and yet may we be earnest evangelists to those who do not yet know you. We pray for those who are low income, God, those without work. We pray for those who are sick and in need of healing. And we pray for those who are sad over being separated from loved ones through death or divorce, through family disagreements. And we remember your promise to comfort those who mourn. Hear now our silent prayers. Precious God, we are ready to restart our faith. Wake us up. We know we're not starting over for you. With you, nothing is ever wasted. But God, we are beginning again with you. We ask you to fill us with faith, with hope, and with love as we awaken now, somewhere in the middle of the beginning of the end. We ask it all in the name of Jesus Christ, the Messiah, the one who has come, the one who is here, and the one who is coming again. We ask it in his precious name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And now, church, the peace of the risen Christ is with you all today.
And also with you.
You are invited to turn to all the people that are around you and wave as signs of graceful greetings on this day. Be sure and wave at our folks that are at home, too.
Thank you. Good morning, Chapel Hill.
Good morning. Good morning.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your words proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. As the scriptures are read, you are invited to stand, sit, or kneel, whichever position creates an attitude of reverence and focus. Hear now these words from Revelation chapter 21, verses 1 through 4, and 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 8 and 9. Then I saw a new heaven and new earth for the first time, first heaven, and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, or the old order of things has passed away. But do not forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like a day. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
I can hear myself kind of reverberating around here. Am I too loud for you all?
No.
All right, I tend to get a little louder as I go, so I don't want to knock anybody out. Okay, I see Judy giving me one of these, so okay. So today we're going to be talking about the second coming, and I want to go to this God of ours in prayer. Will you bow with me, please? Holy and righteous God, you have told us that we belong to you. Jesus, we belong to you. We trust you. We trust your every word. We trust your every move. We trust you to be with us. We trust you. So Lord, today as we visit about the new coming, the second coming, the new year of all of the new things as they transpire, I just ask you to be with me and to be with all of our people today. Help us to look forward to you. Help us to not have that anxiety that happens over just not knowing kind of how every detail of it would be. And Lord, may the words of my lips be acceptable to you And may all our hearts, Lord, be acceptable to you as we lift this time to you in Jesus' precious name. Amen. So before I get started this morning, we've got some people. I didn't know Barbara was here. I just heard her over there, and I'm so glad. We have some people that I particularly want to thank. Roger, Barbara, Gary Gallegos, my husband Bruce, and our friend Mark all went to work at the Magdalena House yesterday, and it was a really wonderful mission. I was so proud of them. You know, I don't know when the last time y'all picked up a rake and raked about an acre of compost was, but I lift weights almost every day, and I want to tell you it's a lot harder work. I have a newfound appreciation for my grandparents who did your farmers. Also, to all of you who worked on our rummage sale. You know, you guys are doing church work in ways, in a lot of different ways here. And for you to do that and then to be back here today, I just thank you for being here. For all of you that are online with us this morning, we're just grateful that you're here. So, this last week, I was in this devotional group with a bunch of pastors, and we were talking about Advent and talking about this week in particular. Some smart aleck posted up this sign that said, saying Christmas is at risk due to supply chain problems leads me to believe that you do not understand the reason for Christmas. Amen? Amen. But I want you to know, Chapel Hill, that I know we know the reason for Christmas, right? So what's the reason for Christmas? Jesus. What's the reason for Christmas? Jesus. That is correct. The reason for the season is Jesus. This is the second week of our Christian New Year. And, you know, I don't want to sound divisive when I say this, but this is just a truth that I'm going to say to y'all Christian people that are gathered here today. People who love Christ are living out a real different kind of a life story and a reality in real time at this time of the year than almost everybody else who's just kind of seeking some sort of redemption in real different kinds of ways. You know, I'm not being ugly about that, but we just said we know the reason for the season, right? Every one of us do all that stuff that people who don't know the Lord and who aren't in church, we do the same things. We all shop, we all do neat things and try to find sweet things for our kids and for people that we get gifts for and all that. But we also do those things that we serve Christ while we're doing them. You know, here's all of these folks that are working another job all week long that come here every week, and they lead our worship, and they do these things. I know Nicole does a lot of things, and she is here serving. You know, so it's just a real different kind of a thing. But the truth is that most of our world is just not wrapped up in Jesus during this season. It's about a lot of things for most people, but it's not really about Jesus, right? And so I was thinking about, we've been talking about the calendar here this last week and about our time. And I don't know how many of you have realized this, probably all of you, but I'm going to say it anyway. Our calendar is like, right, is named after, the months are named after different gods than the one that we serve. You know, the month of March is named after Mars, right? July is named after Julius Caesar. And so there's an importance that we attach to our calendar. But it certainly isn't the thing that is the all in all of our life, right? We look at our calendar and it tells us where we need to be and things that are important in our daily life. We look at the clock and it tells us what's urgent. It tells us, you know, where we need to be like right now, 2-3 hours from now. But Christians are guided by ultimate truth in a real different kind of way.
We are guided by the Word of God, who is Jesus Christ, and it is also the canon, right? The Word of God that tells us about the beginning of time, about the middle of time, and about this new beginning of time, which happens in the second coming of Jesus. But first, do we really believe it? Don't say it out loud. Do we really believe it? Because there's just a lot of people who really don't. Last week, Paul says, you know what time it is. The age has dawned. Kairos has happened, and God has entered into our time space. God has entered into this tick-tock time on our watch and bringing God's life into this mortal life that we're living. You know, when Jesus was raised from the dead, he was the firstborn. But his resurrection signified an entirely different life, coming with the Holy Spirit. He brought us this present age that we're living in now. But there is more. There is more than we can see. And there is more even than we can hope for, because there is the second coming of Jesus and there is the dawning of the new creation. And really, we wait for this second coming and the gifts of God for us to be here. We have to wait. You know, it's been a long time. And most of us really aren't very good at waiting. I'm not. I want to tell you, I'm terrible at it. My husband has this habit of making me wait when it comes to gifts. He wants me to anticipate and savor every moment of the gift opening process, right? He brings me home like a little box that'll look like a jewelry box with a whole lot of ribbons and a whole lot of pretty stuff on it. And set it down, if I'm sitting there working, he'll set it down on the table next to me and say, now don't touch it. Don't pick it up and shake it. Don't do that. It's going to be Christmas before long, and then you can open it, and then you can see what's there, right? Well, I'm worse than my kids are when they were little, and I just hate that. I absolutely hate that. And I know I'm not alone. None of us like to wait. It's about 19 shopping days until Christmas. But for us today, there's a bigger story, and we're going to talk about Jesus' second coming. When we talk about the second coming of Jesus, my experience with this is that almost everybody associates the second coming with some kind of an apocalyptic horror movie, right? Like some kind of thing that's really associated with doomsday thinking. And I know that that's because of the books that have been written about it. You know, I'm not going to mention any names. I'm not giving anybody any publicity. But there's books and there's movies and there's all kinds of entertaining things that are out there about that. When we read in our gospel, we read that there will be signs in the sun, signs in the moon and in the stars. But we don't know when that's going to happen. You know, I served a ministry for 9 years in Oklahoma that had a lot of prisoners that were attached to it and had an awful lot. It was a real ecumenical ministry. And almost every week, somebody brought me a new date that the world was going to end. I mean, seriously, we'd go past that date and they'd go, no, this, it's, we had it wrong. It's, you know, the next time. We don't know when it's going to come, okay? But what's important is how we wait. And what is important is how we make our life journey through this time as we wait. Because if we start out making our journey with Christ with the end in mind, and knowing that that day is going to be out there, then we will live worthy of the call that God has given us. Amen? Amen.
I'm going to say that again. If we begin our journey with Jesus with the end in mind, then we will live worthy of the call that God has given us. And this is important because as Christians, we must live in hope. We must never be driven by fear. We have to live in hope. And so when we think about any place that we go with Jesus, we have to think about the hopeful parts of that. And we can't get some kind of an apocalyptic anxiety over all of it. Because even though we don't know when it's going to end, we know how it ends. We know what's going to happen. And every one of us knows the pathway there because we're going to follow Jesus there. Amen? We're all going to follow Jesus there. In the second chapter of Isaiah, the prophecy, I love this. This is one of my favorite verses in the Bible. We read about the second coming, and it's about a time that swords, weapons of wars, will be beaten into what Isaiah says is plowshares or farming tools, and wolves or predators will lie down with lambs. And that symbolizes all the innocent that are preyed upon by evil and by evil predators. And then in Revelation 21, we read about a new heaven and a new earth. And we read the holy city coming down from heaven prepared, adorned as a bride, beautifully dressed. And that God himself will be with us. Imagine that. Wiping every tear from every eye. No more death. No more crying. No more pain. Because the old order of this world has passed away. I don't know anyone who would not want that life. I don't know anyone. You see, it's just not a fix or repair kind of world that we will be a part of. It's a new world that God is preparing for us, the second coming of Christ. When I think about it, I think about All Saints Day. I've got 21 years of leading All Saints Day and memorializing the most wonderful people in the world year after year. I think about the people in my own life who have passed, people in your lives who have passed, people that we absolutely adore but we don't see right now, right? When we look at our television, you know, this time of the year we always see hospitals and care units and all kinds of places that are raising money to support children with cancer or who are struggling after storms and after disasters in their life. Wouldn't you imagine what this life would be like if there was no more cancer? Imagine. I lived on the border for 9 years. I tried to imagine when I was there what that would be like with no more human trafficking, no more slavery, no more moving guns up and down and in and out of our borders, no more drugs flowing freely from side to side, no more sex trade. Imagine all of us living in a world where every single one of us are loved equally by our King. That never happened in this world, right? A world where there's no more racism, a world where there's no more exploitation, no more poverty, no more child abuse, no more spousal abuse, no more starvation, no more suicide, and no more COVID. This is the new creation that God is bringing to life. We must believe it. We must believe it. You see, the word Advent means the one who is coming. Church, we need to be those people of faith that can look all the way out to the far horizons and be looking longingly, hoping to see Jesus coming in on the clouds, like Scripture says. Because I'm just going to say today that this is a settled matter. This isn't something that there's any question about in anybody's mind. You know, we're not going to just hope this away where we can just kind of have a good time. And it's not like that. We're not just hoping that it's going to happen either. When I was growing up, I still remember watching President Kennedy issue the challenge to Americans to be the first people with enough vision and enough heart to be the first ones to land on the moon. And I still remember the day that astronaut Gene Cernan planted the first flag on the moon. I remember that. You know, I see a lot of you nodding in here. We remember that. You know, the American flag was the first flag on the moon. But I also remember that it was just the most hopeful moment. And in that moment, it's like, wow, if we could do this, what else is possible? Everything is possible if we can do this. You know, hope is never just positive thinking. That's not what it is. Hope is not just some kind of things that we just tell ourselves again and again, you can do this, you know, we can. No, that keeps us going until the day. That's not what it is. Hope is rooted in absolute truth. And our truth is this, that we are anchored in the new creation through Jesus Christ. And this is absolutely certain beyond all certainty, that Christ will come again. Do we believe it? We do. I think of all the beliefs that we share as Christians, we declare this mystery of faith in communion, that Christ has died, Christ has risen, and Christ will come again. But through the years, as I've pastored, this has been really hard for just an awful lot of people that I know to believe and to think might ever be. And what people would always say to me is this. They would say, well, if this is true, how come it's taken so long? You know, what's going on? It's been 2,000 years ago. Why isn't he back yet? And the truth is that in every age, people have believed that this was the age that Jesus was coming, and it just didn't happen. But then you see, we read this really powerful word from 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 8 and 9. Do not forget this one thing. 1,000 years are like one day to our God. It's been almost 2 years since Christ was here. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. God is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish. God wants everyone to come to faith. But church, this is good news. The gospel is always good news. God is patient with us. He is patient with us. Thank God he's patient with me. I need all the patience in the world. God reaches for us and then waits. God is patient with us. God's slowness is about his love for people, about people coming to repentance, about people coming to faith. We're still living in this season of God's patience. But folks, I just want to say, it is the absolute time for us to prepare for the future. It's time to be prepared. You know, when I first answered God's call, I remember one of my first members who waited his entire life to come to faith. I'll never forget him. He's just a really wonderful man, but an old farmer. He's busy. He had important things. His calendar was full, right? He had things he was supposed to be at sunup to sundown. He also worked in the oil field. He was a great husband. He went to ball games. You know, he had grandkids, just all that kind of stuff. But when he was 62, right after he retired, his children convinced him to go to the Walk to Emmaus. And he saw this new vision of Christ and was saved, really saved. And he was changed. And he came back to church and walked up to the front. I'll never forget it. He looked at everybody and he said, "I don't know why I waited. I don't know why I ever thought anything was more important. I don't know why. I wish I had known. I wish I had known." And within 1 year, he passed into the hands of Jesus. I think back to him, and I think Gene probably was shouting hallelujah all the way there. He was just a wonderful man. Look, there's an urgency. There's an urgency to claim our faith. There is an urgency to claim our faith. There is an urgency to live in God's kingdom here on earth. There is an urgency to do the most that we can to bring the kingdom of God here among us now. Amen? And this is the time. This is the time. Last week I asked you this question and I said, "What time is it?" Do y'all remember what the answer is? What time is it? It's time to wake up. What time is it? Time to wake up. What time is it? Time to wake up. Let us pray. Precious and holy God, we are grateful today. We are grateful today. Lord, it is that season to commit. It is that season to give you our hearts again and to rededicate our lives, our hearts, our souls to you. It is that time to wake up and to look for you out on the western horizon, Lord, to look for you coming in the clouds. Lord, there are people that are among us, I know, whom you would call to. And Lord, I pray for open hearts for all of us that you would speak to us now. We ask it in Jesus' precious name. Amen. One of the things that we say in communion, I'm not sure who's going to work serve with me today. One of the things that we say every time that we come for communion, we claim the mystery of faith. Do you all know those words? What is the mystery of faith? Christ has died. Christ is risen.
Christ will come again.
Say it again with me. The mystery of faith is
Christ has died,
Christ has risen, and Christ will come again. And so today, as we come for communion, Christ invites all of us to come to the table and to receive his presence and his grace through receiving the bread and the cup. Jesus says, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. And everything that the Father gives me will come to me, and anyone who comes to me, I will never drive away." So, when you came today, I believe that almost all of you received these pre-packed cups, right? Let's ask God to bless those for us now. We invite you now to spiritually unite with Jesus Christ as God's child, for whom he gave his life, as we receive Holy Communion. According to Luke, when our risen Lord was at the table with his disciples, he took bread, he broke it, he blessed it, and he gave it to his disciples,
and then their eyes were open. They recognized him. So come, Holy Spirit, on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and juice, and make them be for us Christ's body and blood. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, may our eyes be opened as we receive the bread and the cup today. Amen. Let us all say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. So I want everyone to know that's here that you do not need to be a member to come to our table to have communion with us. You just need to want to receive Christ in your life. Amen?
Amen.
So first, let's take our bread. This is the body of Christ, the bread of life given for you. And now, in the presence of Jesus, let us eat the body of Christ. And this is the cup, this is the blood of Christ, the cup of salvation that's been shed for you. In the presence of Christ, let's all share in the cup of salvation. Amen. Let us pray our prayer of thanksgiving. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into our world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, we ask it. Amen.
Amen.
heard a clap out there, and I like it. Woo! We do speak Jesus at Chapel Hill, amen? We do. So, you all, I am so blessed to be here with you through this season. You know, we've talked about the second coming today. Next week, we'll start into our regular Advent, and we'll be talking about Joseph. The week after that, we'll be talking about Mary. And we will be carrying on towards Christmas starting next week, okay? So, now we're going to pray over our offering. And I want to say, you know, there's all kinds of ways that we offer. Yesterday, as I was watching Barbara rake through all of the compost and Gary, and honestly, I wondered if Roger developed an entire new set of muscles. He carried literally so many wheelbarrows of compost up and down. Oh, and my friend Mark, I'm sure did, as a matter of fact. Worked very hard out there. So, all the ways that we offer are God's gifts. They're all gifts that we give to God. But today, we're praying over this offering, the offering of our money and our first fruits. And we're going to ask God to bless you all. And thank you for being generous. Let us pray. Jesus, we're just called to listen to your words. We're called to respond to you with our lives, with our whole life. And so today we just give thanks to God for all that we are and for all that we have. We pray that these gifts that we offer this morning might be used to bring some compassion into this chaos that we live in our world. We give these gifts out of the love of our hearts, hoping that they will heal some of the hurting in our world, hoping that they'll take and make some of the crooked paths straight. May the hills, Lord, that separate us from our sisters and our brothers be made low, and may all the valleys of our isolation be raised up so we will be ready to welcome Christ as one. We ask it in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Thank you.
So I've just got a few announcements I need to make here right quick, and probably I just save the date. We will celebrate the life of Rose Helen Johnson on Saturday, December the 11th at 10 a.m. Is that right? Okay. The Congregational Care Team is honoring Sybil Kane today. I love Sybil. Oh, wow. There is a birthday caravan today past her home, and the address and all is on your bulletin here. Or call Marjorie, you know, to get it. So everybody's going to line up, though, and decorate and stuff somewhere around 2:45, I think. Is that right? Okay. UMW Leadership Team meets Tuesday at 10:30. The Congregational Care Team meets Wednesday at 10. There is a craft event, and this is an amazing thing. I hope you all will come. Our United Methodist women have planned a craft event for the youth and their mothers on December the 12th at 9:45. All the supplies will be provided. Dorcas Circle will be having their holiday gathering next Sunday, December the 12th at Viola's Ventanas. And we plan to return to in-person Sunday school. Can I just take a second and go? Yay! Okay. We plan to return to in-person Sunday school on December the 12th. As a reminder, children pre-K, 2nd, and children 3rd through 6th will meet. Parents of 6th graders have the options of their children attending youth Sunday school. If you are Safe Gathering certified and are interested in assisting, please contact Crystal or Kimberly or Amy, or call through the church office and find out. Also, I'm not sure if there are poinsettias left for purchase, but yes, Debbie and Mamie are saying that they are. And so you may purchase a poinsettia in memory of a loved one to honor friends or as an appreciation gift, and then take them home on December 24th. Oh, one more thing. It's Undy Sunday again, so let's make sure we're going to be collecting socks, undies, and belts for our Allen Grade School kids that are sized from pre-K to 5th grade. And thank you so much for your support. All right. We have worshiped, we have prayed, we have lifted our hearts, we have shared with the body and blood of Christ with one another. We have fellowshipped. It has been wonderful to be in God's house and in God's presence with you. And now be sent with this blessing. Remember that God's promises are real. God always promises, and they are real. Peace be with you, and peace be with all whom you love, as we go now into God's world with peace in our hearts and lives. Leave, and let's go in hope and peace. Amen?
Amen.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.